1, 3, and 5 of the opening hymn. And you may notice that we're playing catch-up with the hymn numbers on the sides. They may reflect last week's service. So if you would like to see last week's service, it is on the website. We'll ask, invite Max van Wyck forward to sing the prelude, The Call.
Such a home. Please be seated.
And good morning. Welcome to Pentecost, the day of the Spirit. And welcome to those if you are here for the very first time. Glad that you are, that the Spirit will help you to find this to be home for the next hour. So those who are tuning in with live stream, glad that you're with us as well this morning. We offer usual invitations on a Sunday morning like this. Coffee and tea and fellowship are always available after worship in the gymnasium or the fellowship hall just through this door here. You can continue the fellowship that you've already begun to discover here. There's programming for three and under in our nursery, and that's available in that direction just beyond the tech desk. Down the stairs for four and up, Sunday Club is available for you, and hope that you're able to be part of it today. Now I bring welcome from myself, Philip Newman, the lead minister here, but also from Simon LeSieur, my colleague in ministry, as well as Gerald van Wyck, the minister of music, who has been here until just recently. And really want to welcome our soloist Max and Baha here this morning. So glad that you are joining us today and offering your gift of music. So all of us bring welcome this morning. Just a few announcements that I will offer to you. You will already be reading in the bulletin that the memorial service to celebrate the life of the Reverend John Gauss has been set for May the 28th. And you can pass the word around about that. I know Joan and Mark look forward to being able to gather with you in that tender time of prayer and yet celebration of all that faith and life have brought to them through John. The Golf Classic has now become the John Gauss Memorial Golf Classic. And we know that John would want us to continue in that friendship and fun event. And so it will continue. You can sign up for that. It takes place on the 18th of June. And in the gymnasium after worship, you can add your name to the festivities there. Tomorrow evening is a journaling workshop. It's still not too late to sign up for that. You can learn how to capture your memories and stories that could very well be a legacy for your family and your friends. That's tomorrow evening. And of course, this afternoon, we look forward to the German Requiem that is being offered. Tickets will be available at the door, but they're also available at coffee hour in the gymnasium as well. There are a few tickets available. And of course, Max and Baha will be featured there. They are Dean East scholarship recipients. And we celebrate that ministry that has been ongoing here. Simon would like to bring us a word about how we can help prepare for our summer preaching series.
Good morning. First of all, I just want to say a huge, huge thank you to Megan, Dylan, and Katie, as well as Kim Logan. As many of you know, last weekend we were away at Camp Kakwa with 21 of the teens from this church, and they absolutely knocked it out of this park. It was, I think in the 6 years I've been here, it was by far the most meaningful event that I've been able to participate in with the young people in this church. And so I just would love for the four of you to just stand up and be recognized for the hard work that you do. As we go into our summer series this summer, there's a way in which you can participate, and you'll find more information in the bulletin. But those of you who are photographers, aspiring photographers, or even pretend photographers, we would love for you to send into the office a picture of a place in this community where you most feel God, or where you most see God at work, whether it's a picture of someone's hands kneading bread at the bakehouse. Maybe it's a flower. Maybe it's the seawall. Maybe it's the sunset. Whatever it is, if you could send a picture of where you most see God in this community, and send that in to the office. One thing that is not included in there is if you could do so by June 12th, that would be really great. It'll give us time to prepare for the summer series, which will start in July. And Philip and I will still both be around throughout the summer series, so this isn't a case of, well, the ministers leave, so they found fillers. This is really, I think, an important way. One of the big learnings from last year was how much we all appreciated hearing different voices, and so we're continuing that this summer. And one last little note, with communion today, the older group, so grade 4 and up, will be coming back to partake in communion, but those of you who have children who are not in the nursery, who are under grade 4, they will be staying with Dylan, and you will be able to get your kids after the service, who will be upstairs in the godly playroom. But the older group, again, will be coming back to partake in communion with us. Switch hats. Let's take a moment, take a deep breath. As we go deeper into worship, we are so grateful for Max and Baha. Many of you who have been part of this congregation for years will remember them, and they have been away in Toronto and Chicago refining their craft, refining their gift that they bring to us. And they're also recipients of the Dean East Music Scholarship. And it's just so good to have both of you. Welcome home. And we always love having both of you. And I would also like to invite Jerry to join them in lighting the candle, because there's an important mentorship. There's a fathership, obviously. But there's also an important mentorship that takes place. And Jerry, we're so grateful for what you do with these young voices and helping them craft into the amazing young people that they are. I don't know if you're young anymore, but...
Please share with me the call to worship this morning. The Lord be with you. The day of Pentecost is here. The day when the flames of faith dance in our hearts. The day of Pentecost is here. The day when our battling speech becomes the good news for the world. The day of Pentecost is here. The day when compassion is seared into our souls. The day of Pentecost is here. Let the people of God rejoice. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
to invite Miriam to come forward. Now this morning for our time of prayer, we have something which I find is very, very exciting. Miriam here, so we'll be praying, we'll be hitting it back and forth like a little game of squash. And even though you'll see on the screen the Lord's Prayer, we won't be saying it together. Miriam will be reading it in her mother tongue, which is Assyrian. Now, Assyrian is a language spoken in northern Iraq and is spoken, they estimate, by only about 200,000 people in the world. And Assyrian is one of the three languages today that that derives and that flows directly from Aramaic, which is the language that Jesus would have spoken. And so when you hear the Lord's Prayer this morning on this Pentecost day, when you hear it in Assyrian, know that you are hearing it in a way that would have been as close as we can get today to what Jesus would have spoken. So no pressure. And so let us pray.
Lord Jesus, who lives in heaven, I pray for stronger and deeper knowledge of you and your teachings, so we know how to structure our lives in a way that you are included in it. For you have given us what we need to be able to live a godly life. Help us find you in times of sadness and fear. We welcome you into our hearts and repent of our sins. I pray for those who need you and are seeking of you. Lord, I ask you to be with the people who have been involved in the Alberta fires. Now is the time that they need you the most, for those people have lost everything, their homes and belongings. Give them patience and hope.
God, on this day of Pentecost, send your Holy Spirit into our lives. Continue to fill us with your Holy Spirit. God, continue to empower us to live out the good news in this world, in a world that so badly needs it. God, this message that you are here, that you are alive. My God, fill us with flame, with wind, and God, that we might proclaim the love that you've shown us. And God, we pray for those who are in need of your peace, who are in need of your healing and comfort. We think especially of Joan and Mark, Barbara, Michael, Brad, Suzanne, Jerry, Janice, Alistair, Lily and her family, and Judy. And Lord, we listen now as Miriam offers up on our behalf the prayer that you first taught your disciples.
Babinti legushmeya, paish kotshoshimuch, athemel kuthuch, hawe etbanuch, tachti legushmeya, hawe ara, helen nachma, sumkanen yomanen, shaklen chubbe wachtaye. لما رتلن جوجرابا إلهم خلصلن إيشا سبب ديوخ إلى ملكوثا خيلوخ دشبخته العالم آمين آمين.
آمين.
Thank you.
would like to invite the children forward for our intro to Sunday Club. And I'd like to invite Hannah Shacklock to come and join me. All right, so everyone, all the kids can come up too, not just Hannah. All right. Good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing today? Good. So last weekend, a group of us were at Camp Kakwa on a retreat, and Hannah here is going to tell us a little bit about her experience at this retreat. And there's just been so many amazing stories that have come out of our time together. And so what we've done is we're going to break it up into three parts. And so Hannah is going to talk a little bit about her time at the youth retreat this week. And then next week we'll have someone else, and then the week after that we'll have our third person. And I hope that you're inspired by their stories. I know I was inspired by how bold and courageous these guys were. And before we go into our little conversation here, I just wanted to share something with the congregation that was really amazing. So sadly, we got the news that John Gauss had passed away on Saturday. But what was amazing about that, and Dylan and Katie had just gone up to go visit John and had told him that we were going to Camp Kakwa with the young people, and he just smiled his huge smile. And what was really, I think, amazing and meaningful for me was knowing that we were there with young people whose parents John Gauss had brought to that very camp many, many years ago. Just a few years ago, I mean. and it was just amazing to see, I guess, how the church lives and breathes and continues. Hannah is here this morning, and she initially asked her if she was willing to do this, and she said, yeah, for sure. And then as I was looking for two other people to do this, she goes, oh, wait, hold on, this is in front of the congregation? And I was like, yep. And she's like, I thought this was going to be in front of the kids. And I'm like, well, basically, we all are kids, right? And then the clincher is, well, I said, well, the PowerPoint says your name on it, so. Anyway, Hannah, thanks so much for agreeing to do this. So for those of us who weren't at the retreat, can you tell us a little bit about it?
The retreat took place 2 weeks ago, a week ago, and it was a small campsite in Hope, and it was right on the lake. It was really beautiful, and there was a lot of activities such as archery and riflery, and also we spent a lot of time in the chapel learning more ways to talk to God and learning more about each other in ways.
That's great. What's one of the highlights that you think the kids would enjoy hearing about?
A big highlight for me would be the rocker. It was sort of like a big beach ball that was on the lake, but with more dimensions. So when you would climb on it, it would tilt back and forth. So when we would get on it, we'd have competitions who could stay on the longest and just start pushing people off. And there was time when I was trying to get on it, and Simon grabbed me by my ankles and just ripped me off. That was really scary.
Yeah. I did,
it was fun.
But I did that prayerfully, right? Now, what did you learn about God over the weekend? I know in your some of the evaluation that you sent back, you talked a lot about how you learned about God. So can you share a little bit of that with us?
I think the biggest thing I learned about God was that He was holy. We did this activity where we learned why God is holy. And there was three posters on the wall. One was of a mountain, one was of water, and one was of a tree. And we were supposed to pick which one we saw God in most. And I picked the mountain. I chose the mountain because for me, I see God so big and so strong and also so intimidating to me. So Megan took us up to the spot near the road, and we had to read a Bible verse a few times over, and then we were just supposed to think of a holy experience in our life. So when I was thinking of a holy experience at that time, I thought of my brother passing his third term in university because he's had so many difficulties and doubts about himself this year. But now when I think of a holy moment, I think of this retreat, because just the way God brought so many different people from different families and different ages and brought us all together as one. And I learned more about anyone in my youth group than I have in the past 2 years I've been attending. And I consider all of them my friends. It was just great.
Thanks, Hannah. I know one last question. I didn't send you this one. It's an easy one. Would you encourage these kids when they're old enough to go on the retreat, or would you say, not really?
No, yeah, I would encourage everyone to go on the retreat.
That's really,
it was really fun.
That's great. So we have a very short video that we prepared for all of you to invite you into what this was like. And you'll see the rocker that she's talking about. So much for the gift of your Holy Spirit on this day. And God, as we head out, may you continue to teach us whether we are one or 91 or above. God, we just thank you so much for the gift of community and the gift of this church family. We pray all of this in Jesus' awesome and holy name. Amen. All right, off we go.
Prepare to hear God's word, let us pray. In our struggle to hear your word, O God, bless even our doubts, our wanderings, our soul struggles, life's deep questions and deeper mysteries. Teach us to love our questions as well as our answers. Amen. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly, from heaven, there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind. And it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them the ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one of them heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages we heard them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'Ah, they're filled with new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea, all of you who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they shall prophesy, and I will show portents in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.'" Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
presume to speak your word, nor may we ever lightly presume to hear your word, for in your word is life. Amen. Well, we heard Gary declare in that passage of Scripture that when the day of Pentecost had come, the disciples were all gathered together. They were in one place when the sound of a rush of a violent wind filled the place that they were gathered together. It was Pentecost. That's the name we've given it. It's a funny kind of holiday. It isn't exactly a traditional family time for Christians, as in, so where are you celebrating Pentecost this year? What dinner reservations have you made for Pentecost? We really don't go that direction. We don't gather in homes for big meals. We don't exchange presents and what to cook. Did you inherit any treasured recipes from grandmother for red Pentecost cupcakes? Or tongues of fire barbecue sauce? I know I didn't. And all the reticence, I think, is really kind of strange when you think about it. Because Pentecost is a birthday party. It's the birth of the church that we're celebrating when they came in power. And you'd think the church would go all out like we do for Jesus in December. But we don't. Pentecost is rather an understated holiday. And I think it's a story that really invites us to go a little wild. You know, wear red, overflow the space with bright red balloons, put red food coloring in our beer, maybe. Let the flames of the banners that have that are new for us today just dance all over the place. The Holy Spirit requires us to make space on this day because the Spirit's a-coming. The disciples had convened the first ever church meeting. They were selecting a new disciple to replace Judas Iscariot. And suddenly there came from heaven that rush of a wind. It filled where they were. And so Pentecost is literally a birthday. The disciples are waiting for something to be born there in Jerusalem. They're not able to exercise control over what's about to happen. They are told by Jesus that he would send the Spirit, but he just didn't tell them when. They knew it was Jerusalem that they should be. He didn't give them a due date, but really, what's a due date anyway? Every pregnant mother has one. It's just an educated guess. And we know the odd thing about due dates is that no one really consults the baby. And babies have a way of keeping their own schedules, and we just have to wait until they come. And the Holy Spirit, the disciples learned, was something of that same mysterious working. There was a lot of waiting around, and in this case, waiting in Jerusalem like Jesus told them to do. And day after day, on edge, unable to make plans, unable to travel anywhere. And if Jesus had only scheduled the equivalent of a spiritual cesarean, well, they would at least know the date to expect the Spirit to arrive. And so the Spirit is a lot like a baby, they discovered. It shows up when it shows up. We're never going to be ready, really ready, for the Spirit's arrival. Our job is to watch and to wait and not let the business meeting close the doors too tightly, and to be ready to get moving when it's time. I was asked at Tuesday Bible study this week, if I always knew that I wanted to be a minister. And I said, actually, the one thing I always knew I did not want to be was a minister. And well, why would you do that then? Well, darn it, it wasn't me. It was that the Spirit continued to interrupt my life. It wouldn't leave me alone. When I was more certain that I did not want to be a minister, and probably a teacher maybe, because my mother was a teacher and I loved to go into her classroom when I had days off and help there, and I could see myself doing that, and I loved the sciences. And I thought, if I could do research, or maybe combine the two and teach the sciences, that's what I wanted to do. That's the track that I was on. And then, my minister preached a sermon. Its title was, Who Gets the Incense? Kind of a strange title for a sermon. Who gets the incense? And it was based on an Old Testament lesson about offering the sacrifice, bringing that sacrifice forward, letting the incense burn and the aroma wafting heavenward and into the nostrils of God. That was what the belief system was, and that would be pleasing to God. And so, the question in the sermon, and it was a sermon that I knew was preached just for me. Now, I was not the only one in that room, in that sanctuary that day, but it became a question that the Spirit planted in me that I could not push aside as much as I wanted to. I did not want my life to be interrupted. I had a sense of the track that I was on, and even when the occasional individual adult would say, you should consider ministry, Philip, I knew, no, that's not the track for me, God, I know. But the Spirit had another idea for me. And so that sermon, that question that stayed with me began months, no, really years, of answering the question, who gets my incense? In other words, who gets the living of my life? And it wasn't going to just be me all by myself. It was, okay, God, you will get the incense of my life that I offer. And this devout scientist gradually began to change and entertain that question more seriously. And you know, I wasn't the only one in the first year of theology that had been on a different track. Rob had been on a different track. He was an accountant. He had a very successful accounting practice until the Spirit interrupted his life. Keith was also in first class of our theology. He was a dentist. He had a wonderful dental practice until the Spirit interrupted his life. And he had to discover what this new track of living with the Spirit was about. And on the day of Pentecost, it was mostly devout people who were gathered together. They were people who paid attention to God. They were not lapsed believers. They weren't pagan. They weren't lukewarm. They were devout people on this day of Pentecost gathered in Jerusalem. They had a firm relationship with God. Devout, faithful folk gathered to celebrate a festival of what they know and believe, of everything, that everything and everything that we grow, everything that we are and have comes from the hand of God. That's what that festival was about in Jerusalem that day. And they gave thanks most of all for the gift of the Torah, the gift of the law that shaped their lives as God's people. Now, that's not a holiday that needs correction by the Spirit, but still it gets interrupted. And I have to ask, what is the Spirit up to with that? And maybe the whole point here is that the Spirit has its own timing, just like babies and due dates. And so human plans only extend so far. And maybe the point here, and I continue to struggle to know just what the Spirit is up to at any given moment, is that the Spirit interrupts what we have come to expect. The Holy Spirit doesn't just interrupt us, it interrupts what we know, what we are sure of. Something else, I think, on that day in this story that Gary shared with us that was problematic for the faithful gathered together, that it was Galileans who were the conduit of the Spirit's rush. Can anything good come out of Galilee? That was the understated question of the day. Everyone knew the answer to that question. Can anything good come of Galilee? No. These people can hardly string three words together. These Galileans, we don't expect much from them. They're not your equals. But when devout faithful of God living in Jerusalem, when devout faithful who have gathered from every corner of the world, we're told in the story, cultured, cosmopolitan people, when they heard the Galilean disciples speaking in other languages and hearing their own native tongue, they said, aren't all these that are speaking Galileans? How is it? How is it that we hear and understand in our language? Now that's unexpected. No one arrived there expecting an experience like that. If we can hear our own language when a Galilean speaks, that totally changes the entire picture, I think, for those gathered together there. It does for me, because if a Galilean who can barely read, who's never had the privilege of a theological education, can play host to the Holy Spirit, can show me Jesus more clearly than I've ever been able to see him, if that's how the Spirit moves, if that's what Pentecost is, well, that changes the whole picture for me, because that means that I'm going to have to rethink everything I thought I knew about God, everything I knew about the world and my place in it, everything else. I have to go back to square one. And that means that I have to look in new ways at the people around me, even those that I've already written off. And can the Holy Spirit do that? I mean, interrupt our lives like that? Erase our sureties? Overturn our best plans? Reshuffle the whole deck? As far as faith and life are concerned, is the Spirit allowed to do that to God's people? Because that's not why I came to church this morning or on any particular Sunday morning. I didn't come to be interrupted even by grace. Give me what I expect, God. Maybe the church is born again every time we gather together in one place, every time we gather together to hear what we already know and to have all of that confirmed, only to be addressed by what we never imagined. And if that's true, then heck yes, Pentecost happens. And you know it. How has the Holy Spirit interrupted your life? What are the Galilean voices that you hear raised up from time to time? Voices you just don't expect. Wisdom that comes out of the blue and just sends you sideways. What are the plans that you are making for your life? And have you consulted with the Holy Spirit about those plans? I mean, you might as well, because it's going to interrupt you anyways. The Spirit is going to interrupt your carefully planned meetings and reconfigure your boundaries, cause you to be hospitable to those you never thought possible, and make room in your plans for new pathways, to move over and make space for unexpected persons and other Galileans. And you might as well enjoy it. And I would recommend that you fasten your seatbelt and that you keep your hands and legs inside at all times, because Pentecost in your life can be a wild and awesome ride. Let's pray. Oh, Holy One, when our hearts are stayed, and our souls just sigh. Renew our spirits. When our ears are closed and our bones are dry, renew our spirits. When our minds say no and our wills won't even try, renew our spirits. Oh God, let your spirit descend on us and light our hearts and souls with love. Amen. Friends, it is the Spirit that gifts our community. It gifts us with talents unimaginable. And so, as we prepare our offerings, we, through those offerings, become gifts to the world. Gifts that bring healing and wholeness, that share compassion and love. And so, let our offerings be received.
Thank you.
This is the table to which God invites us. This is the table that is upheld and surrounded by the Spirit this day. This is the table where we are fed, and I invite you to share in the communion liturgy and to be part of this meal, which is a meal that belongs not just to us, not to just this select group, but this is the meal to which Jesus invites all, and this is a table to which we are welcome. Friends, may the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
May the Spirit of Pentecost be with you.
And also with you.
Open your hearts to the Spirit of grace.
Lift them to the one who rushes into our lives.
Join in one voice praising God.
With our hearts aflame,
we sing praises to God. And friends, may I say to you, the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
And let us share this peace by standing and turning to those nearby. Communion prayer, you will want to have the music. It'll be on the screens, of course, or the hymn book. And we will be moving, alternating between the song, Spirit of Gentleness, and the words of the prayer of communion. The words spoken will come from Simon and myself, and your response is the musical part in which we all join together. And I would suggest to remain seated as we say this.
Spirit of Gentleness.
From the very instant of creation, your Holy Spirit moved on the waters of creation, bringing to life the creative love that is God.
People were forgetful and stubborn. Your Holy Spirit called to them to be unafraid and to follow. Your Spirit led them through the desert to a land they could call home.
During all the times of fear and tumult, you sang the song of hope through the prophets. You called people back to you with tender forgiveness.
On a dark winter night, you sang your sweetest song and birthed a Savior who came to bring us life and witness to your love and power.
Simple people, the fishermen, to come and to follow you, and they witnessed your miracles of healing and your forgiving love.
When the night seemed to be the darkest, even though it was midday, you gave your Son to be a witness to your love. From his cross, he forgave those who crucified him and reminded a thief that paradise would be his home.
On the early morning, the women were startled with the news of his resurrection. Could it be that all he said was true?
The disciples hid in fear of what others might say, think, or do. They were astonished at his presence to them.
Spirit, Spirit of gentleness, help us to dream dreams and to see visions of all that is possible for the healing and hope of this world.
Thank you.
us cross the lines which divide and unite to proclaim boldly that you are the spirit of absolute love and peace. Emblazon our spirits. Make our voices bold. Bring joy to our hearts as we eat at your table. Because we've been called to be witnesses, even to the ends of the world. Amen. On that night, you gathered with your disciples. You broke the bread. You gave thanks. And told us to do this in remembrance of you. God, we give you thanks.
And at that same meal, he poured out a cup, gave thanks, and shared with them that his actions were shaping a new covenant in which they all would live. And we give thanks to the living Christ for that covenant that is ours and the world's. And I would invite forward the servers that are helping this morning just to join us on the main floor at the front. So what's going to happen now is obviously that our servers are going to form stations, and there will be four stations formed across the front, and you'll be moving forward using the center aisle once they're in position, and then returning to your seats using the side aisles. There will also be a couple of moving mobile stations who will serve those in the chapel, and anyone else that's unable to move forward, simply raise your hand so that they can see you as they move about this morning. is helpful for you on the mobile at the mobile stations. These are the gifts of God ready for you who are the people of God. Please come and enjoy. We'll begin with the last row, actually. Sorry. How embarrassing, God. Starting with the last row. The last shall be first. Feel free to move to any one of the four stations at the front. Thank you.
Spirit, you have inspired us today to be witnesses to God's love and power. Help us be joyful in our service and strong in our faith for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now we go in peace, with God's peace in us and all around us. Amen.
The face of Christ in the people we meet, and may they undoubtedly recognize the face of Christ in us.